All right, so let's see.
Let's remember what the hell we were doing. Oh, so weird. Somebody back there, turn the one off that says, I think one of them says hi. There you go, cool. All right, so even before last time, we were sort of talking about how if I draw out a probability distribution, so a lot like a dartboard, the area representing the part that I'm interested in is equal to the probability that I'll get something in that area, right? As long as the whole thing's area is one, right? So the area of the entire thing is one, then any little sub-area of it, any little piece of it, the fractional piece, that's the probability that something in there would happen. That's the beauty of giving a visual of the probability distribution. So with normal curves, we know they have this bell shape. But what's horrible about these, we started with uniform distributions. So what the hell is a uniform distribution? Some of you guys are like, yeah, what the hell is a uniform? Somebody remember what a uniform distribution is? Yes?
Isn't that discrete?
Say again?
Discrete?
No. That would be binomial or something. Uniform was the first continuous one. And it's the one that, if I was going from 4 to 10... how tall would it be? And that what we just did, what you guys just helped me with, is you made the area of this thing one. And the idea, what's the idea of a uniform distribution? That word uniform, we normally think of everybody wearing the same outfit. So uniform probability distribution means that everything gets the same probability. So that's why it makes sense they're all the same height. Because the height is related to the percentage that's there, which is related to the probability, right? So if I drew out, look, this bar graph. What's the most likely thing to happen just looking at that picture? 7. Yeah, that's the most likely thing to happen. Because it's the tallest bar, it's the largest area is right there. I like it. And then these out here are very unlikely, right? They're unusual. There would be more than 2 standard deviations away, for example. Right? Okay, so kind of merging a few different ideas. So here's a uniform distribution. If I make the height 1/6, that makes the whole area 1. So then if I want to know what's probably, it was from 5 to 7, well, what's the area of that little piece?
2
times 1/6. So the area of this little piece is 2/6, 1/3. It's a 1/3 chance. So the something happened every 4 to 10 minutes, evenly spread out, and what's probably have to wait from 5 to 7 minutes, about 1/3. It's probably just going to happen within that time frame, 1/3 of the time. Okay, maybe. So if only the thing was a simple geometric shape, like a rectangle, even a triangle, then it would be easy. I could just use geometric formulas, no problem. Triangle, I got 1/2 height times base, yay, right, easy. So, of course, the most commonly occurring distribution in a lot of the statistics that we're going to look at is one that does not have a nice geometric formula, right? If I draw a little piece of this, I can mark up this one, I'll use that. If I just say, what's the probability it's in the here? Well, what shape is that? Shit, I have no freaking idea. This is not straight. It's not quite a trapezoid. Right? Even a trapezoid would freak some of us out. But maybe you guys remember it's 1/2 times the sum of the bases times the height. It's almost like a triangle, but it's been beheaded. But it's not even that, because this side is curved. Shit. I really want you to understand. So that's why we have to use something else. We have to use, thankfully, we're not going to learn calculus in here, so don't freak out. We had a computer do the calculus for us. That's where this comes from. But that's what the computer did. It just cranked out all the areas between, from one side up to a certain z-score. So if you look up a certain z-score, it's going to tell you the area from all the way down up to that z-score. So for example, what's the area? Holy crap, you're in there, Jeff. What's the area from negative infinity? So from all the way down up to like negative 2. Well, that would be right there. 0.0228. That's how much area is in there. So we can't just calculate the area of a rectangle for normal distributions because one side is all curved. Oh, shit. So we had to get some help. We got some calculus and we had some programmers do some software and computer, and it just cranked all these numbers out for us. And now we can just use the numbers. Right, but it's still the same idea, still the area. So where should the areas be largest would be closer to the mean, right? That's where the thing has the tall, is the tallest. Right? And where is this, where are these numbers changing the least? They're changing the least way at the edges. Because how much area am I adding if I go from here to there? Not much. But then if I go really close to the mean, look how much they're changing. They're changing by quite a bit. If I go closer to the mean, because as I move, and now I'm changing, if I go this much, I'm adding this much area in. Holy shit. Okay, maybe. Maybe. Alright, so just to review a couple of problems from last time. To use this chart, if I want to know the probability z is less than 1.51. So what's, for z scores, what's right in the middle?
Zero.
I love it, because the mean is zero away from itself, and a z score is the number of standard deviations away, right, to that data point. So I'm talking about the mean, it's zero away from itself. That's amazing. So where's 1.51?
Right.
No, where's it? Down here or up there?
To the right.
To the right. I like you guys. Let me answer you differently than you asked. Okay. So that's 1.51, somewhere up there. It doesn't really matter. And I want to know less than. So I want to know that area. So if you draw the picture for yourself and shade in the question, you'll make less silly mistakes. If you don't trust me, then go ahead and make all your silly mistakes. What the hell? But if you look up 1.51, the chart is hardwired to tell you the area below it. And that's exactly what this question is asking for. What's the area below 1.51? So another way to say this is, if your z-score for your test grade was 1.51, and we know how to calculate a z-score, x minus x bar divided by the standard deviation. Does that sound vaguely familiar? No. Do you guys remember how to calculate? Oh, look at these colors. Freaky. Oh, boy, I can get really high. Oh, boy. Oh, man. Somebody stiffened that too much. Some teacher walking around like this orange mustache.
Oh, yeah.
So this guy, what's the formula for z equals x? You can do like mu over sigma, or you can do x minus x bar over s. No matter what, it's always our data point minus the middle divided by the spread. That's what it always is. These are not two different formulas. This is population symbols. This is sample symbols. But the formulas are the exact same. So does this look familiar? Okay, okay. So if you calculate, what do I tell you after every test? I tell you the mean and the standard deviation. So you could calculate your z-score. You could take your test grade minus the mean divided by the standard deviation, calculate your z-score. If you had a 1.51 z-score for your test, and the test scores were normally distributed, what percentage of the students scores below you? Well, if you look up 1.51, and here's how this chart works, 1.5, and then the second decimal place is out here. So 1.50, 1.51, 0.9345. And I know if you were here, we did this one already. I'm just trying to catch everybody up. So this means that there's 93.45% down there, 0.9345. So if the test scores were normally distributed and your z-score was 1.51, you would have scored higher than 93.45% of everybody else. If your height has a z-score of 1.51, you'd be taller than 93.45% of other people, right? So that's you guys start to see that. I just talked about heights and test scores, but I'm using the same damn thing because this just talks about the shape of it. That's all it cares about. If it's normally distributed, I don't care if it's the length of dogs' tongues or if it's how long salamanders live or how crispy marshmallows get, whatever the hell it is. If it's normally distributed, I can use this thing. That kicks ass. But I can only use this thing if it's normal, and of course I have to know the Z-score because it's a freaking Z-score chart. Makes sense. So, hopefully that's enough. So that's a really quick one, but let's see what happens. So what's wrong? We did all these last time. 9, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 9, 7, 5, 4, all these other ones we did last time. So what's kind of wrong with number 4 in a way? Why can't I do number 4 the same way we did, you know, way back at number 1, the only other problem on there, but... Like here, this number is a Z-score I gave you, right? That's a Z-score. You didn't have to change it into a Z-score. This number I give you here, that is not a Z-score. That is a raw score. That's a measurement in the real world. I need to make it into a Z-score first. So if I can make something into a Z-score and I know it's normally distributed, I could use it. All the answers are just sitting there waiting. Okay, maybe, maybe. So let's see. How the hell? Well, first off, let's draw what I always, when I took statistics, Mr. Pearson, good old Mr. Pearson, would make us draw two of these damn things. But here's what I do now. What goes right in the middle? Careful, it's not zero. With the mean, and what's the mean? 31.64. Now let me see if you guys get this. Right underneath there, I'm going to put a zero in parentheses. So of course that represents the Z-score, I love it, right? So you put raw scores, and then underneath the parentheses, you put Z-score. So you don't have to draw the same damn picture twice. It's going to have the same exact shape. It's just that the numbers are going to change them to a Z-score, right? So what number am I interested in? 27.2, where's that at? It's down here, I like it. It's 31, 27 is down here. My God, don't put numbers just wherever. There's a purpose for this picture. If you draw it correctly, it'll tell you if your answer makes sense. So here's 27.2, and what's the area that I'm interested in? Where do I shade? Yeah, less than. So it's going to be this little tiny area right there. So right now, automatically, I know it's going to be less than 50%. I know my answer's got to be less than 50%. Now, I don't know really much more than that, because where did I put 27.2? I just kind of put it below there. But that's the key thing, is it's just a rough gauge to make sure that your answer makes sense. Now, what's this guy's Z-score? Well, shit, I gotta take a second and figure it out. How do I do the Z-score for 27.2? 27.2 minus? Yeah, 31.64. My data point minus the mean divided by standard deviation, which is 7.81. So the only difference between these problems and these problems is that these haven't been made into Z-scores yet. There's just one extra step. So what are you, let's see. Well, I didn't bring any calculator, so. I don't know why I deserved an evil laugh at all. There we go. Did it work down there? Sure. So I get, so be careful when you do it. You do it all at once, as long as you tell the poor little calculator that has no eyeballs that's the top, parentheses, divided by 7.81. So I get this here. Is that what you guys get?
0.56.
I like it. So what would he round it to? It's a Z-score, so it only goes two places because the chart only goes two places. -0.57. Truly round. You're in 160. You should not have rounding issues. If you do, make it so it's not an issue. Right? Come on. So -0.57. All right, let me stop there for a second. Make sure everybody's with me so far. We've already done Z-score calculations. The Z-score formula is relatively simple. And what it does is, this is why it doesn't matter if I'm talking about salamander, length of life, or marshmallow crispy, whatever the hell I was talking about earlier.
Because I make it into a relative score based off the mean. So the original numbers don't mean shit when I make it to a z-score. So I know that it's like a little more than half a step down from the mean. Is that cool to say? Right? It's negative 0.57, so it's a little more than half a step down from the mean. So once I get this number, does it matter what the mean was? No. It just matters that it's 0.57 steps down from the mean. And then the chart's going to give me the probability that it would be that or less. And is that the question? Yes, thank God. It's the below there that I want. So what do you get when you look up negative 0.57?
0.2843.
Cube. Negative, yep, there you go, buddy. Negative 0.5012345672843. Sweet. Be really careful. One of the biggest mistakes that I see is people treat this as 1. This is 0.50 and then 0.51. And of course, you can just look up at the top. But sure. Where'd it go? 2843. So below this thing that I just looked up. So this is negative 0.57, this z score. And below that is 0.28. What was it? 43? 2483. Yeah, Jeff. 2483. And that's the answer because that's what they were asking for. If they would have said greater than, I would have had to do 1 minus to get the other side. To get the opposite side, it's 1 minus that. So you guys try the rest of this. If you haven't already done this. Try these two. It's not a quiz. Check with people near you if you want to.
Thank you. squares.
Say, I only got so many bless yous, man. What the hell? From the picture, you know, the answer for that one should be small. Assuming I just remind you, remember I told you about the shortcut. If it makes If the shortcut makes complete sense, you can use it. If it only makes a little bit of sense, forget about it. You'll just misuse it, it's no good. Okay, how's everybody doing so far, is that right? Again, how is this useful? Well, now I know that almost nobody takes, thank God. I mean, if I was out of college and I did this calculation and I got like 25% of people took almost an hour to find a parking spot, that's not a good selling point, right? And this is not that great, but almost everybody finds a parking spot here in less than 53 minutes. Wow, that's amazing. All right, but some of you guys, have you lived this reality?
Yes.
Doing, being the shark, you ever been the shark and like following somebody forever and they get to the car like, no, I'm just getting another book. Boom! So I understand. Okay. So here, the same idea. This is going to be a lot like the one we did up here. We knew the z-scores though, so we looked up the areas that we subtracted in the middle. Here, there's just one step. I've got to change each of these stupid things in the z-scores because neither one is a z-score yet. Again, in the middle, it's 31.64. Now I need 15.5 and 19.5. I don't want that little area between there. So the z-score for 15.5. Where did it? 7 point, what was it? 8 points? All right, real quick. You can't just subtract 15.5 and 19.5. I've had people do that in the past. But the formula, the idea of the z-score is how far away from the mean you are, not how far apart two scores are. So you have to make each one their own z-score. What do you guys get for that? Let me see if I can...
-2.07.
Oh, Nina.
I got -2.06.
Oh, is that for the other one? I'm doing 15.5 right now.
Oh, yeah.
So -2.07?
Yeah.
2.07? What did you get? 2.06 what? You remember?
It's 2.06.
It might have been, let's see. Ah, 6.6, so then you got to round up, right? So let's see, 15.5 minus 31.64, 7.81, got it. 2.06, yeah, 2.07. Got to round up. 2.07. That's this guy's z-score. What about 19.5? Here's a nice thing. Let me show you in the calculator real quick. And this might not be the most amazing thing right now, but the formulas we're using are going to start to get a little bit bigger. So watch. Oh, get out. There it is. So if you have the old calculators that help you grow the square root symbol, you can hit second enter. It still works for the new ones. You hit second enter, and it brings up the last thing you wrote. And then you can go back and make this 19. Boop. You know, if you want to. It's not that big of a savings of time, but when the formulas get stupid big, and you're like, oh, that was supposed to be a minus. Ah, now you just hit second enter. Go change it. You don't have to type the whole damn thing in again. Thank the gods. Right? Okay. So that'll be -1.55. Because it's a 4 next to it. Sorry, that was the wrong time. But at this level, you guys should be able to round. -1.55. So if I look up -1.55, the idea is that's too much because it goes forever down. So what area do you guys get for -1.55?
0606.
155 area, 0606, I agree.
Yeah.
I concur. And what about for -2.07?
-0.0192.
Yeah. 0.0192. And now you just subtract them, because if you subtract them, you'll be left with that area in there. So it makes physical sense. That's crazy. Gallery. What do you get?
0.0414.
Please, your God, if you turn this around, don't leave it in negative. You can't have a negative probability. Don't just leave it negative. So 4% chance that it takes somebody between 15 and a half and 19 and a half minutes. And this is for a week, by the way, so I guess the hour wasn't too bad.
Just make sure I have this right. You go to each one of them separately, and then back the z-scores, and then subtract them and get them 15.
subtract the areas below each z-score to get the area in the middle. If you subtract z-scores, you change where you are.
Okay, the area.
Yeah, you get a whole new z-score, which means it was related to a whole different time than either one of these. So that answer wouldn't relate to this problem at all. It's a really simple mistake to make. But you got to look up both z-scores and subtract the areas. That makes physical sense. Okay. Subtract the bigger area, the smaller area, the bigger area, get the area in between. So what about this last one? Oh, shit. So now watch. Now let me show you something real quick here. This formula here, and I know you guys just love formulas to death, but what is, how is this useful? It's already solved for z, so this is most useful when I know x, I know mu, I know sigma, right? That's when this formula is most useful, because it's already got z sitting there. So if I know this, this, and this, plug them in, bam, I get the answer. So if I didn't know this, but I knew these three things, this formula is not the best. It'll work. But this is where algebra comes in and says, all right, let me help you out there, buddy. Let's make a better formula for if you don't know x, but you know everything else. This is good if you don't know z and you know everything else. Right? That's why in algebra you had to do all that manipulation of equations that didn't have any numbers in them. Right? And you're all like, oh, math people just sit and think of ways to torture you. Well, that's true, but this actually had a practical reason. So how do I solve this for x? Huh?
I multiply the sigma.
I like it. So whenever you have a fraction in an equation, a really good idea is to multiply by that denominator, so you've got no fractions no more. So if I multiply both sides by sigma. So now again, let me write this like this. You write it however you want to, Jeff. Z sigma equals x minus mu. And then I add mu. I love it. So that's some algebra. Open this out. So if I add mu to both sides, I get mu plus z sigma. Have I been showing you that formula before? No? Okay. Now watch. Who remembers?
You guys always want to know what's on the test. And I told you a question that's on the test, and a lot of you still get it wrong. What question am I always going to ask you every test? Who remembers? I told you already. There's going to be one question on every test. What does the z-score tell you? Right? So every test, I'm going to ask you, what does the z-score tell you? Now look at this. You're not allowed to have notes. You're not allowed to have examples, any of that shit on the formula sheet. But look, I really want you to notice, and you guys don't fully believe me, and I don't care because it's true. Math is a foreign language, and I can read this in English. So how do I get to a data point? I start at the mean, and I go this many standard deviations. So what's the z-score tell you? The number of standard deviations away from the mean to the data point. Holy shit. So when I ask you, what does the z-score tell you? This formula tells you. It's the number of these away from this to this. Now fill in all those thises with the word and you're there. The number of standard deviations from the mean to the data point. Oh my God. So every math equation actually has an interpretation like that, believe it or not. I mean, it's got to, because it's based on, a lot of them are based on physical realities. So how does that help me on this problem? Good Lord, not the guy. Oh, wait. How do I find the 14th percentile? We've done a problem like this before. Where would it be on the picture? Where's the 50th percentile on the picture? Right in the freaking middle, because that's where it's got 50% below it. So where's the 14th percentile? Way down here. It's supposed to have only 0.14 below it, right? Notice that I put the 0.14 up there because what goes up there are areas, percentages. That looks like a z-score, but that is not a z-score. I don't know what the z-score is yet for that. So this is a backwards problem. What do I normally tell you? I normally tell you the x, the minutes in this case. You make it into a z-score with the formula, and then you look it up. So here I gave you the area first. So you look it up and find the z-score that relates to the area, and then you use the backwards formula that we just did on the other sheet, Jeff, to take it back to an x-score. Yes?
So if it's worded like P33 in the other one, or 14th percentile, then you need to work backwards?
Yes. Anytime, or the top 5%, remember that was the other one? Anytime it gives you the area, the percentage, the probability first, and I ask you what's the score or whatever, you've got to work backwards. So
in this chart where our areas, they are in here, I know I've got a negative z-score because it's down here. Is that cool? What's the closest I get to 0.14 in this chart? I see 1492 kilometers stay on the ocean blue. Oh, look at that one. What's the closest I get to 14%? My gosh. It's not a seance.
Oh, gross.
Anyone know stats?
Negative 1.8.
Well, close. I see what you're saying. Yes. So the closest number I can get to 14% is 0.1401. You guys see that? What z-score does that correlate to? Negative 1.08. Fits perfect. See, that's 14.01. Where is that, Jeff? There. See that 1401 right down there? What z-score is that related to? Negative 1.08. So I'm just looking at this backwards. If I can look a z-score up and find the area, I should be able to find an area and look the z-score up. Just the other way around. Math goes both ways. Okay. So now I can use, I know that z-score that correlates to this is negative 1.08. Now what's the raw score? What's the number of minutes that that relates to? X equals mu plus z sigma. Very skinny sigma up there. So x equals 31.64. And then actually this is going to be like minus 1.08. Is that cool?
Yeah.
And the standard deviation is 7.81. So it's just a little formula to... So if I go down 1.08 of these from the mean, I'll end up at that data point. At that data point. What do you guys think?
23.21.
I'm going to say 23.21 roughly. Minutes. About. So if it took you that long total for a week, you're in the 14th percentile, which in this case, is that good or bad?
Good.
That's good. You want less time, plus you really enjoy it. Oh, this is awesome. There's nothing available. Oh, there's an open one. Shit. No, I doubt that happens very often. It's the best part of my day. Look at the word. No, it's not. All right, how are you? You guys all right? This is huge. I can't tell you how big this is because we're going to start talking about the first adjustment to this procedure.
I have a question back on 1B, and it's 5%. How come, because I wasn't here that day when you... Like I left early that day, but how can you put it on the right hand side? But it's like
0.05,
but you put it on the right side.
Because it says 5% of a normal curve above it. That's why.
Above the mean?
No. The z score, so that's the line, mm-hmm. that has 5% above it. So it can only have 5% above it. So if I put it down here, well, this is 50% above it. 40, 30, 20, and then, so right here is about 5% above it.
Okay.
That's one. If I would have said 5% below it, it would have been here. Yeah. Cool. Which is, I guess, why that line is there. Okay. How are we doing? Everything else on that one okay? All right, so in case you didn't notice, So let me do this. Let's take some time. Can you guys do me a favor and like actually find one or two other people to group up with? Is that right? I love some of you guys working. I don't believe them. If some of you would do that, I would really do it more in my heart. If you really don't want to, then screw you. Don't. All right, so I want you to work on this. This is kind of like, it's got some of the stuff all the way back from 4-1. The very last problem, the second number two, Jeff. I love you, Jeff. What did you teach again?
It's got this stuff on it. So if you want to start with the very last problem, that's the stuff we just did. It's not a bad idea. Let's put one in here for example.